Good evening, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. I'm Senator Evie Hudak, one of the proud co-hosts of this event. Thank you. I'm the chair of the Senate Education Committee and also a member of the Colorado PTA Board of Directors, which I have been for 19 years. I'd like to thank our co-hosts. There are other co-hosts for the night. The Colorado Association of Middle-Level Educators, Colorado Fair Share, Colorado Interfaith Worker Justice, the Colorado Progressive Coalition, Denver Alliance for Public Education, Denver Classroom Teachers Association, the DCTA Club 30-ish, and the DCTA Retired on behalf of the DPS retirees, Jobs with Justice, the National Education Policy Center, UCD School of Education and Human Development, United Opted Out, Representative Crisanta Duran, this is her district, and Senator Andy Kerr. We have a number of dignitaries with us tonight, and first and foremost, of course, we have teachers, parents, principals, and assistant principals. Thank you. We have Senator Andy Kerr with us. Denver School Board members Arturo Jimenez, Jeannie Kaplan, and Andrea Merida. DCTA President Henry Roman. And Carolyn Crowder, the Executive Director of DCTA. The Colorado Association of Bilingual Education. Gracias. That's about all I can say in Spanish, but thank you. And we have the following candidates for the Denver School Board. Rosario C. DeBaca running for District 2. Meg Schomp running for District 3. Roger Kilgore running for District 4. And Mike Kiley running at large. We also have former State Senator Pat Pasco and two candidates for the State House of Representatives for Denver, Jeremy Van Hauser, Jeremy, and Aaron Silverstein. I owe you, Jeremy. Sorry about that. So you probably know about Diane Ravitch, but let me just tell you a few things about her before she comes out to speak. She's a research professor of education at New York University and a non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. A prolific writer who has published more than 500 articles and reviews for scholarly and popular publications on the subject of education. Ravitch is an internationally acclaimed writer for her expertise on past and present education. Her most recent book, The Death and Life of the Great American School System, How Testing and Choice Are Undermining Education, makes the case that public education today is in peril. Drawing on her over 40 years of research and experience, Ravitch critiques today's most popular ideas for restructuring schools, including privatization, standardized testing, punitive accountability, and the multiplication of charter schools, and she offers a clear prescription for improving America's public schools. Beyond academia, Ravitch has made a name for herself in politics as well. As Assistant Secretary of Education and Counselor to Secretary of Education Lamar Alexander from 1991 to 93, she led the federal effort to promote the creation of voluntary state and national academic standards. appointed a member of the National Assessment Governing Board, NAGB, in 1997 and reappointed in 2001, she oversaw the National Assessment of Educational Progress, NAEP, the federal testing program. Diane has a blog that she'd like you to know about in case you don't already, dianeravitch.net. It has 65 million hits. 65 million. In 2010, the National Education Association selected her as its Friend of Education for the year. And she's a native of Houston, a graduate of the Houston Public Schools. She received a BA from Wellesley College in 1960 and a PhD in history from Columbia University's Graduate School of Arts and Sciences in 1975. Without any further ado, Diane Ravitch.
I have this new book that came out a week ago. And the first place I went to was Pittsburgh. The second place was Philadelphia. Both of these very, very sad cities because the governor of Pennsylvania cut the education budget by $1 billion while cutting corporate taxes. And the stories there could really break your heart. This is the third place that I've come to. And I love Denver because I had a wonderful reception here 3 years ago, and I'm very happy to be back. Happy to be with my friend Jeannie Kaplan. Who is a great friend of the teachers and educators of Denver. And so I want to tell you about my book. The first thing, and I don't know if this was mentioned earlier, because I was blogging in the back. and just to clarify, because Edie couldn't read my scrolled handwriting, my blog started in April of 2012, at the end of April, and it has since then had 6.5 million page views. So the word is getting out about the fight that we are having to save public education in America. And I have 61,000 followers on Twitter, and that's more than Michelle Reed. So I received incredibly exciting news when I arrived in Denver. As soon as I checked in my hotel room, my editor from Knopf called me and said, "Sit down, your book is number 10 on the New York Times bestseller list." And, you know, for an author, that is an unbelievable piece of news. It means that people are excited about the message. They're telling their friends, and I don't know how they got the message. No, I know how they got the message so fast. We identified about 100 people who love public education who are bloggers, and the bloggers put the word out. They got early copies of the book. It was blogged all over the country to educators, and educators have put this book on the New York Times bestseller list. Now, I want to tell you about the book, and it's a hard-hitting book. It's very controversial. But I want to start by telling you what I decided to use as the epigram, two epigrams for the book. The first is a quote that you're probably familiar with. It's one of the most famous quotes about American education, written by John Dewey about 100 years ago. And he wrote, "What the best and wisest parent wants for his own child, that must the community want for all of its children. Any other ideal for our schools is narrow and unlovely, and acted upon, it destroys our democracy." What that means, in shorthand or longhand, is that what the parents in the rich suburbs want for their children is what we want for all children. And just to show exquisite political balance, the second epigram comes from a very crusty conservative who was a president many, many years ago, John Adams, 1785. This is what he wrote, quote, "The whole people must take upon themselves the education of the whole people and be willing to bear the expenses of it. There should not be a district of 1 mile square without a school in it, not founded by a charitable individual, but maintained at the public expense of the people themselves." And then there's the epigram that I asked the editor to put in, and she forgot about it. So I'm going to share it with you. It goes like this. It's an old English saying, and it dates back a couple of hundred years. And listen closely, because it's easier to read than to hear, but you'll get the point. The law doth punish man or woman that steals the goose from off the common, but lets the greater felon loose that steals the common from the goose. That's what's happening today in American education. We are supposedly engaged in an era of school reform, but somehow reform has turned into a process that includes budget cuts, firing teachers, firing librarians, closing libraries, firing guidance counselors, firing social workers, closing public schools, turning public dollars over to private managers and private entrepreneurs, and pretending that test scores are the most important outcome of schooling. Many teachers and principals feel that they have become public enemies, and sometimes it seems that public education itself, the elimination of public education itself, is the goal of these reforms. And this cannot be reform. So I describe in the book what it actually is. It's destruction. It's a series of hoaxes. And so I'm going to go run through with you some of the hoaxes. There are many more than what I'll describe here, but they're pretty much all covered in the book. Hoax number one is No Child Left Behind. The hoax of No Child Left Behind was based on the idea that there was a Texas miracle. We now know there was no Texas miracle. It was a hoax. So then we have a federal law that says that by the year 2014, 100% of all children will be proficient in math and reading. No one in the Congress believed in that it was a hoax, but they passed it anyway. And they're closing schools based on a projection that no state is able to meet. The state of Massachusetts, which is considered the top performing state in the nation, on the NAEP has 50% proficient. 50%, not 100%. And so this is a mighty hoax. The second hoax, race to the top. It is not working. It is causing more teaching to the test. It's demoralizing teachers by imposing a flawed and ineffective and harmful evaluation program. It leads to more school closures. Only they're not called closures, they're called turnarounds, because we deal in euphemism here. And then it never poses or answers the question, why are we racing to the top? What is the top? The very idea of a race to the top means winners and losers. The goal of American education is not for some to win and most to lose. The goal is equal educational opportunity, not a race to the top. Now, the first several chapters of the book is devoted to presenting facts, evidence. That's something that you will not hear from the reformers. What you hear from them is theories, hunches, claims, arguments, baloney. What I have is graphs taken from the website of the U.S. Department of Education that establish, beyond question, that test scores in the United States today are at an all-time historic high for white children, black children, Hispanic children, and Asian children. Have you ever heard that from a reformer? No, never. They'll tell you our schools are failing, achievement is flat, it's declining. It's all a mighty hoax. It's not true. I have the graphs to prove to you it is not true. Over the past 40 years, NAEP has been tracking performance, and the improvement has been dramatic over 40 years. It stopped, by the way. It stopped in 2008. At the very point when No Child Left Behind and Race to the Top converged, with all this test, the test scores went flat on the long-term trend. So the very thing that they claim to value the most, they cannot get. And what they're doing is driving out experienced teachers. Then comes the claim that our high school graduation rates are just scandalous. The fact is, and again, there it is on the website of the U.S. Department of Education, high school graduation rates have never been higher in history than they are today for white children, black children, Hispanic children, and Asian children. So, a hoax. Then they say, well, we have a dropout crisis. How many times have you heard that claim made on television? Dropout rates today are the lowest they've ever been in history for white children, black children, Hispanic children, and Asian children. Then they say, oh my goodness, look at those international test scores. We're losing the international race for something. I forget what we're racing for. But what they don't know or what they won't acknowledge is that the first international test was given in 1964. There were 12 nations that took it. We came in dead last. In the last 50 years, we have outperformed by every measure the other 11 nations. Test scores on international tests prove who's best at test prep, not whether the economy is going to go up or down. What they also will not tell you is, as it happens, on the last international test, which is called TIMSS, they never talk about TIMSS, they only talk about PISA, and they say we were number 16 or 12 or whatever. On the last international test, which came out just last December, so they know the results, our kids did incredibly well in math and science and reading. In fact, our fourth and eighth graders tied the kids in Finland. Can you believe that? They didn't tell you that, did they? Black students in Massachusetts performed on the same level as students in Finland, but they didn't tell you that either. That was a big secret. It didn't make the front page of any of our newspapers. I'll bet it wasn't in the Denver Post either. And then comes this other hoax, which you will hear about in relation to every part of our economy, and that is that somehow the private sector can always do it better. And so we're offered privately managed schools called charters and a growing demand, not on the part of people, but on the part of the politicians, to just hand out the money to the parents and let them choose anyone they want. And what we know about the other thing they'll tell you about the for-profit sector is it's good to have a for-profit sector. Now, I know you don't have a for-profit sector in Denver, but in my book, I do have a chapter about the for-profit schools that are spreading across the country now. In the state of Michigan, more than 80% of the charter schools operate for profit. There are entire districts in Michigan that where the test scores are low, and the governor, being a far-right extremist, instead of doing what the state is obligated to do by its constitution, which is to support districts that are running out of money, he simply gave the entire district over to a for-profit manager, who will then be paid more than the deficit that the district had. In Ohio, there are for-profit managers that are reaping hundreds of millions of dollars. Well, what's the secret of their success? The secret of their success is they're making so much money, and they contribute it to the politicians, and the politicians never hold them accountable, never close down their failing schools, and they keep their lousy schools open year after year. They speak at their graduation ceremonies, even though their schools, even by the state's own measures, are bad schools. But the political money, which comes from taxpayers, is being used to buy off the politicians. So what we'll also hear is that technology is going to bring about a dramatic change in education. And the terms that they use are customization, personalization, and individualization. That's a hoax. What they really mean is that they'll put kids on a computer, they'll cut the number of teachers, they'll have one of my ex-friends in one of the right-wing think tanks said, There'll be a barn somewhere in Kansas with a teacher, and that teacher will be monitoring a couple hundred screens. And think of the savings. So the kids will interact with the screen, not with a human being. But that's not education, it's a hoax. It's a matter of just saving money. It's not about improving education or helping kids. So we have virtual charter schools, which is the biggest hoax of all. You have one in Colorado, the Colorado Virtual Academy. Wherever these virtual charters exist, they are a hoax. What they do is that the name of the game is recruitment and enrollment, keeping the enrollments up. Recruit, recruit, recruit. The reason they have to recruit so much is they have a 50% dropout rate every year. And then when their test scores come out low, as they always do, because the kids lack any motivation to sit at home in front of a computer and learn from a screen, they make excuses. They say, well, we take these high-risk kids. Well, they're not taking high-risk kids. They're just they forget that their mantra is supposed to be no excuses. For them, there's always an excuse. Now, the reason that the online charter schools have done very well is because they're immensely profitable. And I have a chapter in my book on the virtual charter industry and what's made it so profitable. The biggest of them is K-12, created by the Milken brothers. You may remember Michael Milken. He went to jail for the junk bond king. He now runs K-12. They recruited Bill Bennett, who had been the Secretary of Education, to be the chairman of their board because they thought he would have great appeal to Christian homeschoolers. So that was the organization they put together. They now have about 200,000 kids. Of course, every year it's a different 200,000 kids because it comes and goes, but it's very profitable. The CEO of K-12, whose educational background consists of a time spent at McKinsey and Goldman Sachs, his compensation is $5 million a year. And it's based not on performance, but on enrollment, because enrollment is what matters to these schools. So now we have the latest fad, which is, of course, we have to buy tablets, we have to buy iPads. So the city of Los Angeles has just taken money from a voter referendum on school construction, 25-year bonds, and this money, $1 billion of it, has been invested in an iPad for every student. Now the iPads will be obsolete in 2 or 3 years, and those 25-year-old that 25-year obligation will still be there long after the iPads have been replaced. And then yesterday I saw online in stories from the LA Times that these iPads are supposed to be secure so that the kids couldn't use them for anything but school. But our kids are so smart, they broke the code. They broke the code, and they're now using it for Facebook and gaming and social media and Pandora to listen to their favorite music, and probably for porn, who knows. And they will lose them, and they'll be stolen, and there'll be technological problems. And the district, after committing to spend $1 billion, forgot to buy keyboards. Now, it turns out you need a keyboard, because if you're going to take the Common Core test on the iPad, the keyboard on the iPad takes up too much space, and you can't see the test. Oh, dear. So many problems. When you consider that Los Angeles now has class sizes in many places of 40 to 50 kids in a class, and that schools are crumbling, and that they've pink-slipped thousands of teachers, why are they spending $1 billion on iPads when they should be taking care of their schools? So it's a hoax. What it's all about, and this is what the holy grail is for the reformers, is to reduce the number of teachers and to have one teacher, lots of screens, like the rocket ship charters. One teacher, maybe a teacher, or maybe not even a teacher, acting as a teaching assistant while 100 kids are sitting in front of a computer. What they really are hoping for, the reformers, and they're very clear about this in the charters and elsewhere, is first of all to cut costs, and secondly to break the unions. You may have noticed that. So there is this theory amongst the reformers, and I hear it again and again, and I have a chapter in which I quote them saying this, that the way to improve American education is to find those bad teachers, of whom there seem to be a great many, and fire them. And so this is why we have this zeal for teacher evaluation, because the reformers believe that you can be judged by your test scores, and then the people who have students who get low scores, it's their fault, and therefore you fire them. And there was a court case a couple of years ago in Colorado, actually, which you may be familiar with, where Lena Darling Hammond came from Stanford to testify against Eric Hanushek. As it happens this coming week in September 30th, I'm going to be at Stanford, hosted by Lena Darling Hammond on a panel with Eric Hanushek. Eric Hanushek goes around the country and testifies in court cases saying, we don't need more money. Schools don't need more money. Money doesn't matter because it's always going to be badly spent. We just need to fire bad teachers. He calls it deselection. And Linda said something that I've always remembered. It's a great line. She said, you cannot fire your way to Finland. She's right. It's a hoax. What all of this emphasis on firing has done is to create massive demoralization. And this has been documented in the MetLife survey of the American teacher, which comes out every year. It was documented in a Scholastic and Gates survey, which I think Bill Gates didn't read, showing that teacher demoralization and principal demoralization is pretty close to an all-time high, and it's gone up very dramatically, particularly since 2009 with the introduction of Race to the Top. So reformers like to say that what they really want is to elevate the status of teaching as a profession, but what they're really doing is destroying teaching as a profession. Just this morning, I got a note from someone in Los Angeles, a new report that enrollments in teacher preparation programs have plummeted over the past 3 years. Young people don't see any point in becoming a teacher. They see that teachers are being laid off by the thousands. They see the disrespect in which teachers are held. And what's the point of going for a teacher preparation program? Well, consider what happens in some of the countries that we think of as being good places for teaching and learning. I'll use Finland as an example because I visited there a couple of years ago, spent a lot of time visiting classrooms, talking to teachers and principals and researchers. To become a teacher in Finland, you apply after high school to enter a teacher training institution. They accept 1 out of 10 applicants. It's a very rigorous selection process. Once you are selected, it's a 5-year program. Once you have gone through your 5-year program in which you've done deep study of subject matter, of children, of teaching children with special needs, of all the different things that teachers need to know to be good teachers, and part of the 5-year program involves a lot of practice teaching, then you are a teacher and you are assured a job for life. And furthermore, every teacher and every principal in Finland belongs to a union. They belong to the same union. Doesn't seem to be a problem in Finland. They do very well. So the reformers believe, very few of them you will notice, you may have already noticed, very few of them have ever taught unless they had 2 years in Teach for America. They earnestly believe that teacher evaluation is broken. I think the reason they believe this is because they went to elite Ivy League schools and they see themselves surrounded by graduates of state universities and they think, oh, good grief, why can't everyone here come from Harvard, Yale, and Princeton like me? So they think that the problem is we have low test scores because of bad teacher evaluation. So you get something like SB 191, which is one of the worst pieces of legislation in the United States. When I was in Denver 3 years ago, I was invited to speak to some breakfast meeting or lunch meeting where a lot of civic leaders come, and I was to debate Senator Michael Johnson, and it was at the very time when 191 was being debated in the Senate. And we waited. We had our lunch, we waited, he didn't show. And so I got up and I gave my side of why I thought what he was doing was wrong and why it would never work, and this is what the research shows. No sooner did I finish than he came in. I had the sense that he was waiting outside the door to make sure that he didn't hear anything that I said, he didn't have to respond to anything that I said, and that he could come in and talk about how his legislation would create great schools, great leaders, great teachers, great everything, and just deliver the typical line of political BS. So here's what I have learned about test-based evaluation. 95% of the testing experts in the US believe that it is flawed, that it creates invalid ratings, that the ratings will change from year to year without anyone knowing why, that a teacher may be declared effective 1 year, and then the next year, the same teacher will plummet to the bottom and be ineffective, and that when researchers ask the teacher, what did you do differently, the teacher says, I have no idea. I did exactly what I did the last year when I was effective. And so what happens is, in New York City, when our teachers got rated, the teachers who were declared to be the 99th percentile, the very best teachers, wrote a joint letter saying, we denounce our ratings, we don't believe in them, they're worthless, because next year we could be at the bottom. They knew it. What researchers like Audrey Amron Beardsley, she's at Arizona State University, she's about to bring out a book, which will be out next spring, about teacher evaluation. She wanted to call it Vamboozled. And her publisher said, we need an academic title. So it has something like a title of Rethinking Teacher Evaluation. And I said, no one's gonna know, you know, this is a very exciting book. She said, teacher evaluation by test scores is like flipping a coin. It's about that accurate, throwing a dart at a dartboard. It does not identify great teachers. It does not identify bad teachers. It can identify teachers who are good at teaching to the test. They look good. Teachers who are teaching children with disabilities will look like they're ineffective teachers because they're not getting big gains. Teachers who have English language learners will look ineffective because they're not getting big gains. Teachers who teach the gifted will not get big gains. They're already at the top. One of my grandsons goes to a public school in Brooklyn, and his principal is absolutely horrified by all of this test-based evaluation. And she told me the story of a teacher in her school who teaches gifted children. And the kids come in, the top score in New York is a 4.0. The kids come in at a 3.92, and the computer says that at the end of the year they're supposed to have a 3.97. She got her kids up to 3.95, so the computer said that she was one of the worst teachers in New York City, by 2/100ths of a point, on a test of, in my view, dubious validity. But this is ridiculous. What Linda Darling Hammond has written is that the test-based evaluation will say more about who was in the classroom than the quality of the teacher. Have a couple of disruptive kids, suddenly your test scores will not look as good as they did last year. But the reformers believe, based in large part on the work of Eric Hanushek at the Hoover Institution, that the more teachers you fire, the better the teaching corps will be, because eventually only the great ones will be left standing. This is so ridiculous that I can't even answer it. It's a hoax. And then in many states, I forget whether Colorado is one of them, you can tell me if it is, in the effort to improve education, the legislature has abolished teacher tenure. Have they abolished it here too? Okay, so what this means is by abolishing teacher tenure, you're removing from teachers their right to have due process. That's what teacher tenure is. Pete, when the public hears the word tenure, they think of higher education, where tenure means a job for life. In K-12, tenure means due process. If they want to fire you, they have to produce evidence once you have been evaluated and the principal says that you've done a good job. But what you're also doing when you abolish tenure is you're abolishing academic freedom. There will be places in this country where evolution will never be taught again without tenure. There will be places in this country where controversial books will not be taught. There was a school board just the other day in North Carolina that banned the teaching of Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man. I can't tell you, you can only look at the list. The American Library Association puts out a list every year of the 100 most banned books of the year. Most of them are classics. Most of them will not be taught where there's any community objection to them. Kids won't, in many communities, will never hear about global warming because there are some people who think it doesn't exist. They don't care about the ice cap melting. That doesn't mean anything. And then there are those reformers, and they are many, who believe that the reason that we need to really shake things up is because we have to get rid of unions, because unions are bad. I have debated them, and my question is always, if you think that unions are bad, why is it that if you look at the NAEP scores, the highest performing states in the country are Massachusetts, New Jersey, and Connecticut, which are the most unionized states in the country? And then they change the subject. Because that's a hoax too. So then we have another hoax, which is the belief on the part of the reformers that young college graduates with only 5 weeks of training are just as good, if not better, than experienced teachers. Just keep churning, and that will not be good for the profession. And then another of the hoaxes of our day is the belief that the scores will go up if teachers are offered more money to raise test scores. That's called either merit pay or performance pay. I have a chapter in the book explaining that merit pay has been tried for almost 100 years. It has never worked anywhere. So the question comes up, why doesn't merit pay work? I mean, it's such an American idea. If you pay people more, they'll work harder, right? Well, let me ask you, do you think that teachers are hiding their best lessons? I mean, like, are you sitting back and saying, I'm not going to teach as hard as I can until they offer a bonus? So what has happened every time there's a trial of merit pay is there's a control group, there's an experimental group, and they get the same results because everyone's doing the best they know how. They don't know how to do any better. So if we want to see higher test scores or if we want to see better education, Maybe we need more professional development. Maybe we need better materials. Maybe there are many things we need, but merit pay is not one of them. What merit pay does, and this has been demonstrated again and again, even in the corporate world, is that it causes people to not collaborate. It causes them to compete with one another. And so if you sit around the table and say, how can we help this child? Everybody has to say, well, wait a minute, I'm in competition with these other people sitting around the table. I better not tell them what I know. No, that's not the way it's supposed to work. The way it's supposed to work is you collaborate, you're a team. The culture of a school has to be a strong culture of collaboration, and merit pay destroys that culture. Now, possibly the most irritating of, although it's not the worst hoax, it's the most irritating hoax, is to hear a reformer like, whether it's Michelle Rhee or Joel Klein or Arne Duncan or Bill Gates say, poverty is just an excuse. Now, you know it's not an excuse. Poverty really hurts kids. It hurts families. It hurts communities. It is disabling when you don't have the money to go see a doctor and you're sick. It is disabling when you don't know if you're going to have a home to go to at night. If you don't know, if you can't be sure there's going to be a meal on the table, that really gets in the way of your concentration on your schoolwork. Ignore the fact that the latest census data and economic studies show that the income inequality in this country today is the greatest that it's been in the last 100 years. Ignore the fact that the top 10% is now consuming something like more than 50% of the income. The middle class is hollowing out and more people are falling into poverty. That's why I think when we talk about reform and school reform and charter schools and this one, merit, it's all a great distraction. They don't want to talk about what really matters, which is that the amount of poverty in this country is a scandal. The other day I wrote a blog about this because there was a report that poverty was on the rise in New York City, and Mayor Bloomberg's been mayor for 12 years. He's on his way out, thank God. I'm sure he's probably throwing a little money into your school board election. He likes to do that. He was asked, well, what about the rising poverty? And his response was, send me your billionaires. We need more billionaires in New York City. So I juxtapose his statement with the statement that's engraved at the base of the Statue of Liberty by Emma Lazarus about send me your poor, send me your needy, send me your tempest tossed, send me your, you know, against the we don't want the tempest tossed anymore. We want billionaires. That's what the mayor wants. So the encouraging thing was that in this most recent election, some people thought he'd done some good things in the city, but the one issue that people were most down on was his education record. That after 11, now almost 12 years, of being in sole control of the schools, he has the approval of somewhere between 20 and 25% of the voters. So no candidate wanted to be endorsed by him. That was good news. So then we have the reformers' ace in the hole, which is charters and vouchers. And they say, we must save poor kids from failing schools. Now, there's been a lot of charter research. And it shows that some charters get high scores, some get low scores. That's the only thing people ever look at is test scores. But on average, they find there's no difference between the performance of charter schools and public schools because so many of the charter schools skim. So many of the charter schools have high attrition. Many of them exclude English language learners or have half as many as the neighboring district. And many of them will not accept the students with disabilities unless they're the very mildest kinds of disabilities, like speech disabilities. The charters, and this is one of the biggest hoaxes of all, you're gonna either love me or hate me for saying this, the charters claim to be public schools, they're not. They say they're public schools when it's time to get the money. They want public money, but not when it comes to complying with state laws. They will not comply with state labor laws, with any kind of laws or regulation about student discipline. There was a court case, and I write about this in my book. It went all the way up to the Ninth Federal Circuit Court in California. where a teacher said that he complained about a charter school having fired him and then forwarding his record whenever he applied for a recommendation, and he couldn't get a job anywhere. And he said that was an unfair labor practice under, I think he was from Arizona, under Arizona law. And the charter school said to the federal courts, but we're not a public school. We're not subject to that law. We are a private corporation. It went all the way to the appeals court in San Francisco, which upheld the charter school and agreed they are not public schools. They are a private corporation with a contract to the state. They're not public schools. Then came a case in Pennsylvania, which has labor laws protecting collective bargaining, and the employees of a charter school wanted to be part of a union, and they took a vote, which would have unionized them, but the charter founder appealed to the National Labor Relations Board and said, we are not a public school, we are a private corporation operating under contract to the state, and the NLRB agreed with the charter school that they are not a public school. I'm convinced they're not public schools. So therefore, I refer to charter schools and public schools. When they agree to be subject to the same laws and the same regulations as public schools, I call them public schools. And then comes the issue of vouchers. And vouchers are curious because Milton Friedman began advocating them. He's a libertarian economist, a great man from the University of Chicago, who believed in, you know, freedom to choose, no government regulation, deregulate everything. The only country that's really adopted his remedies whole hog is Chile under the dictator Pinochet. And things haven't been going so well lately because the students in Chile have been having regular social protests and demonstrations because what vouchers have done to Chile is to increase social stratification, segregation, best schools for the rich, worst schools for the poor. And so that doesn't faze the voucher supporters here. There are now 17 or 18 states with vouchers or some kind of tuition tax credits that operate like vouchers. Just a couple of weeks ago, North Carolina, I think, became the 18th state to adopt vouchers. North Carolina used to be a very progressive state. It's not anymore. It's now totally in the hands of exceedingly reactionary politicians, the governor and the legislature. Vouchers, they have a history. Milwaukee has had vouchers since 1990, and the cry in Milwaukee was, we have to save poor kids from failing schools, those failing public schools, so the voucher program was created in 1990. It was expanded in 1998 when the Supreme Court said they wouldn't interfere with the expansion of vouchers to include religious schools. So there's now 23 years of vouchers in Milwaukee. And just a couple of years ago, the voucher schools started taking the state test. So we know something about their performance. Poor kids, minority kids, in the Milwaukee public schools and in the Milwaukee charter schools and in the Milwaukee voucher schools do exactly the same. In many respects, the public schools, which are now overloaded with special ed kids because the voucher schools and the charter schools don't want them, the public schools do even better, despite the fact of having the more expensive kids to educate. So vouchers have been a flop in Milwaukee. There's been a voucher program in Cleveland since 1995. The voucher students do no better, and in many cases worse than the public schools, which are abysmal. And if you look on the NAEP, Milwaukee and Cleveland are among the two lowest performing districts in the country. So when you hear the reformers say, we need competition and choice, tell them about Milwaukee, tell them about Cleveland. Here are two cities that have had competition and choice, and the Cleveland and Milwaukee hasn't been assessed for that long. Cleveland has been on the NAEP for many years. It's flatlined, completely flatlined. What's unique about Cleveland? Virtually 100% of the kids in the Cleveland public schools are poor. It's one of the saddest districts I've ever visited. DC has had vouchers at the behest of Congress since 2003. It was evaluated by a voucher-friendly evaluator, as all of these evaluators, by the way, come from the same shop where they believe in vouchers. But even they can't find anything to say other than, well, the graduation rate is higher if you don't count the kids who dropped out. So in Milwaukee, the evaluator, Patrick Wolf, trained by Paul Peterson, a great supporter of vouchers, said, I can't find any discernible difference in test scores, but the graduation rates are higher. 57% of the kids dropped out before reaching 12th grade. So of the survivors, there was a higher graduation rate. So then we get to the other, another of the hoaxes, which is the hoax of New Orleans. You've probably seen all these TV specials about the miracle of New Orleans. Isn't it wonderful? New Orleans had this hurricane that killed so many people and wiped out the public schools and wiped out the union, and they got a fresh start. I think that's what Arne Duncan said. He said that Hurricane Katrina was the best thing that ever happened to education in New Orleans. Wiped out the public school system, wiped out the union, and now more than 80% of the kids are in charter schools. What we know about New Orleans, don't believe what you see on television, is that somewhere between 70 and 79% of the charter schools are rated either D or F by the state of Louisiana. Now, this is a low-performing state, and that district, New Orleans, is one of the lowest-performing districts in the state of Louisiana. Another hoax. Then we have this hoax that goes like this, and you've experienced it in Denver. Closing schools creates better schools. But if the school was getting low scores because the kids couldn't speak English, closing their schools doesn't make them learn English better. If they were getting low scores because there are a lot of kids with disabilities, it doesn't change the fact that they need extra help. There are real things that could be done to help those schools, and instead they're closed. And 5 years from now, the new schools will be closed unless the needs of the children are addressed. What closing schools does is that it decimates communities, and it deprives communities. When you close a community schools, you drive a stake right in the heart of the community. Then comes another hoax. If kids can't pass tests, make them harder. I can't tell you how many times I've heard this said seriously on television. Our tests are not hard enough. That's why our kids are not. If you make them harder, the kids will stretch, and they'll keep stretching, and then they'll learn more because the test got so hard. That's what they're going to do with the Common Core. That's what they did in New York. We just had the Common Core test. And we went from about 60% of our kids were passing the state test. When the Common Core results came out, it was 30%. Dramatic drop across the state, and it's causing an immense backlash because suddenly it's not just inner city kids that are being targeted. It's suburban kids, and their parents don't like that. They don't like being told that their child, who's passed everything in school and whom they know to be bright, who they know is a good reader, whom they know can do the math, is a failure. Why is their child a failure? I'll give you two explanations. One, when they designed the test, they designed the test to fail the kids. I spent 7 years on the National Assessment Governing Board. I am not a testing expert, but I went to enough meetings and listened to enough testing experts to tell you that when they design a test, they know exactly how every item on that test will function. They know that this is an easy one, this is a hard one, this is a medium one. This one, we expect 35% of the kids to pass, this one, 90% will pass. They know in advance exactly what they're putting together. And that's why in New York State, our state leaders said, before any child had ever taken the test, they said, we expect 30% to pass. How did they know? They knew because they designed it that way. The other thing you should understand about the test is every test has a passing mark. It's called a cut score. And that cut score is put wherever the officials want to put it. If they want more kids to pass, they drop the cut score. If they want more kids to fail, they raise the cut score to make it harder to pass. The other, one last thing on the Common Core testing, tests were held with deep security so that no one was allowed to see them before or after they were administered. And a reporter from one of the newspapers got a copy of the fifth grade test and shared it with me and some other people to get feedback. And I looked at the test questions. They were very, very long passages. The questions were very inferential. And having spent 7 years reading test questions on NAEP, I went to the NAEP website and started comparing them to the release questions. And I said, these are not, it's supposed to be a fifth grade test. I compared them to the eighth grade release questions. They would be considered hard questions for eighth graders. Why were they giving these questions to fifth graders? Yeah, you got it. So they would fail. That's what happened. It's a great hoax. But in terms of the testing, the biggest hoax of all is that tests should have the purpose of diagnostics. Tests should be something where you can see whether your children learned what you taught. And when you take a standardized test, whether it's the PARC or the Smarter Balance or whatever it's called, they didn't teach your children, you did. They don't know what your children have studied unless you buy the Pearson books or whatever it is they're selling to go with the test, and then you follow their script. But what you need as a teacher is you need to be able to give the test, get the instant feedback, and know this is what my students need to know. This is what they didn't learn. I have to reteach it. This child didn't get it. This one did. This one needs more help. You learn that as a teacher. And that's why what you must understand is that there is no other nation in the world that is testing every student every year. What we're doing is totally ridiculous. It is a hoax. What are those other nations doing? They might test children on some kind of a national or state exam twice or three times in the course of their entire school career. But in the meanwhile, they let teachers make up the test. Can you imagine trusting teachers? The reason there's so much testing is because the people in your capital and in DC do not trust teachers. They think you don't know how to make your own test. And this is ridiculous because you, if you write the test, you get instant feedback, you can help the kids. Our Common Core test in New York were administered in April. The results came back in August. No one was allowed to see the answers or to see the item analysis for any individual child, meaning that there was no value whatsoever to them. The entire diagnostic value is lost when the teacher isn't even the same teacher anymore, and the results come back so late that you can't help the kids, and you can't see the items to find out what the kids didn't learn. So it's ridiculous, and you have to know this from the outset. It's a giant hoax. Now, another of the hoaxes is this belief that our policymakers have, since so few of them have ever been in a classroom other than as students, is that they believe that testing is the best measure of school quality. Testing, standardized testing, is a measure of family income and family education. Standardized tests reflect opportunity to learn, not capacity to learn. And now I will tell you what I consider the biggest hoax of all, building to this crescendo. The biggest hoax of all is the claim made that school choice is the civil rights issue of our time. This, you must remember, has been the Republican rallying cry for the past 50 years. It has now become the bipartisan rallying cry, and we have people who claim to be Democrats saying school choice is the civil rights issue of our time. I am sorry, Dr. Martin Luther King was not marching for school choice. He was marching for rights. Dr. King marched so that children of all colors would have equal opportunity to learn and not to be able to opt out of the public system where children would have rights to go to a system where they have no rights. Dr. Martin Luther King was assassinated while fighting for the sanitation workers of Memphis who wanted to organize. But this claim that school choice is now a civil rights issue, which is ridiculous, turns parents into consumers, not citizens. Citizens recognize that they have a responsibility for the common good, while consumers look out only what's best for themselves. They want to find the best shoes, they want to get the best bargain. But whether your children are in public school, or private school, or religious school, and even if people have no children at all, you still have a civic obligation to support public education. It is our commons. We must not steal it from the goose. A free and democratic society has a strong public sector and a strong private sector. A strong public sector has a free public library. It has police protection, even if you don't need the police. It has fire protection, even if you never have a fire. It has public beaches, public parks, public roads. They're free and they're public. It is a civic responsibility to support public education. It is not a consumer choice. So now, if you will permit me, I will talk not about hoaxes, but about reality. I would like to think that we are reality-based educators. Children start off in life with different advantages and disadvantages. The obligation of a society is to do the best it can to level the playing field for all. Schools can help to do it, but they cannot do it alone. There is an achievement gap that exists on the first day of school. To blame it on teachers before they've even met the children is absurd. It starts before children get to school because they have differential opportunities, different exposure to vocabulary, different learning experiences. So here is the agenda that I present in my book. And I say in the outset of the book, the reason I wrote a follow-on to the last one was because I was told, your critics say you have no solutions. So here are some solutions. First of all, prenatal care for every poor woman who can't afford prenatal care. Now, you might wonder, what's that got to do with education? Well, the March of Dimes in the United Nations published a report just last year saying that women who do not get prenatal care are likely to have children either who are born dead or who are born with developmental deficiencies or cognitive delays. And we know that these children, in many, many instances, will need special education for the entire time they're in school, which will cost our society hundreds of thousands of dollars when we might have given them, at a very reasonable cost to society, the care to avoid the issues that they will, and many of them will face. So it is an education issue to provide good prenatal care for everyone. Early childhood education, crucial. And you know, and every one of these things that I'm going to mention to you has a mountain of research to support it. A mountain. I mean, the Nobel Prize winning economist James Heckman is one of the most fervent advocates for early childhood education. Now, another thing where there is, again, a mountain of research, and reformers hate to hear this, but it's true, is that when children are struggling, they need reduced size class size. There is, the research on it is just indisputable, and I've got it all in the footnotes of the book. All children should have what they don't have now, unless their parents are well-to-do and live in the suburbs, or go to private schools. That is a full and rich curriculum, including the arts. Including daily physical education. Not taking bubble tests in the gym, but actually moving. All children should have courses in history and literature, science, mathematics, foreign languages. That's what the rich kids get. Why shouldn't all kids get it? And here's a secret that would raise test scores dramatically. Medical care for all children whose parents can't afford it. If I could ask Bill Gates for one thing, it would be open a health clinic in every school in every poor neighborhood. Make sure there's a school nurse in every building. There's so many other things that we know, again, based on experience, based on research, helps kids. It helps to have a school psychologist, to have social workers, to have a library, to have librarians, to have after-school programs and summer programs. There is a summer learning loss. All these things make a difference. All of them have the research to back them up. Charter schools should work with the public schools. They should not compete. They should be collaborators. They should do those things that public schools are not doing well or cannot do. Charters should be for children who are not making it in public schools. They shouldn't cream off the best kids. They should take the kids where they can prove that there's a better way and help public schools learn to do it better. There should be charter schools for dropouts. There should be charter schools for autistic children. There should be charter schools for children who have tuned out and need extra motivation. We should not judge them by their test scores, but their success in turning kids around who have given up on themselves. Now, what we know about test scores is what I earlier said, which is that it mirrors family income. The most important thing that we could do to raise test scores would be to reduce poverty. That's hard, but you know, when you put together racial segregation and poverty, it's what I call a toxic combination. And imagine if Arne Duncan had taken that $5 billion that he spent on Race to the Top, and instead of using it to harass teachers and close schools, had created incentives for schools and districts to improve desegregation. What we also need is the opposite of what we're doing now in terms of the education profession. We need to make it stronger. Teachers should have at least a full year of professional education and practice teaching before they enter the classroom. Principals should be master teachers. If we're going to ask principals to make a judgment about whether teachers are doing a good job, they need to know how to help the teachers. They need to be able to go into a classroom and say, you could be stronger here and stronger there. They need to not just be an executioner, they need to be a coach and a supporter. And to do that, they themselves must be master teachers. Superintendents should be experienced educators who understand teaching and learning. Experienced superintendents with an education background can hire businessmen to do the business. Now, the testing, as I've said earlier, should be used diagnostically. Testing should never be used for carrots and sticks. It corrupts the testing. Teacher evaluation is important. I do not discredit it or discount it. The teacher should never be evaluated by the test scores of their students. It puts too much emphasis on the scores. It leads to, when you evaluate teachers by the test scores of their students, it leads to narrowing of the curriculum, it leads to gaming the system, it incentivizes teachers to avoid the hardest to teach children who need them the most, and it leads to cheating. Now, how should teachers be judged? They should be judged professionally. The best program that I've heard of, if it hasn't been killed yet by Race to the Top, is Montgomery County, Maryland's Peer Assistance and Review Program. And I write about this in the book. The way it works is that when a new teacher comes into the school, that teacher is assigned a mentor who works closely with the new teacher and reports back to a committee made up of teachers and principals about the progress of the teacher and whether or not they're making, you know, doing well or not doing well. If a principal decides that a tenured teacher is falling asleep on the job, falling down on the job, not a good teacher anymore, she will ask that a master teacher be assigned, a mentor be assigned to the tenured teacher. And the tenured and the mentor will work with both the new teachers, the tenured teachers, and the committee will be asked to make a decision based on the recommendation of the mentor. That system has worked very well. More than 200 teachers have been fired because they did not improve, they would not improve, they, for whatever reason, they were judged by their peers and by experienced educators. They were not judged by test scores. They considered this a valid judgment. They did not contest it. They considered this to be an appropriate professional judgment. Test scores didn't enter the equation. Now, another recommendation is that schools that need help, schools that are struggling, should get help. Not closing. In my view, if schools are closed, it means that the people at the top have failed. Accountability does not start at the bottom. It's not with the privates and the PFCs and the lieutenants. It's with the generals. And if the general loses the battle, it's his fault. It's on his head. There must be a professional process in which schools are evaluated in terms of what their needs are, and the help that they need is delivered in a timely fashion. They may need smaller classes. They may need extra social workers. They may need more bilingual instructors. Whatever the need is, the school system has a responsibility to respond to it and make sure that the schools have the resources they need to succeed, rather than punishing, penalizing, firing, and closing. This is all penitentiary talk, not education. So I believe that we must treasure public education. We must make it stronger and better. We must reform it. I'm a reformer. I don't like these people who've stolen my language. I don't like the status quo. All the things I've been talking about are the status quo. I'm opposed to the status quo. This is a destructive, demoralizing, harmful, anti-democratic status quo, and we must all become true reformers, not false reformers. We are all responsible to support public education. The purpose of education is what's been forgotten in this current movement, whatever it's called. I call it corporate reform. The purpose of education is not to race to get higher test scores, but to prepare children for the duties and responsibilities of citizenship. We want our young people to have the wisdom to vote well, to be able to serve on juries. We have to remind voters that one day they may be in the docket, and they want those 12 citizens thoughtful and well-prepared to think about the evidence before them. Our young people, who will be adults very soon, have to make wise decisions to maintain our society into the future. What matters most is not test scores, but that we have schools where students learn to think about the consequences of their actions, where they learn to treat others with respect, where they learn how to live and work in a world of rapid change, and where they gain the knowledge and the skills to make our society more just, more civil, and to bring us to that hope for a day when our society has liberty and justice for all. Now, let me say, and because you're in the throes of this corporate reform movement, it may be hard to see it, but I'm going to say to you that I'm very optimistic about the future. This so-called movement, the corporate reform movement, is built on a mountain of hoax, error, and untruth. Parents are organizing across the country. Students are organizing. The public is beginning to get the true picture of the effort to privatize their schools and to destroy the teaching profession. The opt-out movement is growing across the country. I'm sure you're all familiar with the story of the Garfield High School teachers in Seattle. They said, no, we're not going to do this. But they all got together and said, we're not going to give this test. This MAP test is useless, it's expensive, it's a waste of our time, it's a waste of the kids' time. And the superintendent threatened them. First they thought they might be fired, then he said he might cut their pay. Nothing happened because they all stood together. No. I'll be in Seattle tomorrow meeting with the leaders of the Garfield High School protest. Voters in Florida last fall, Florida, red, red state, were asked to approve a resolution that would have rolled back the constitutional amendment that prevents vouchers. And by an overwhelming majority, they said no, they don't want money to go to religious schools. Just a couple of weeks ago, there was an election in Little Bridgeport, Connecticut. It was all about who would control the school board. The Democratic machine wanted to keep control in the hands of the mayor, who wanted mayoral control, who had hired Paul Vallis, who was one of the stars of corporate reform. And the voters said no, and they elected three insurgents to the school board. And the Atlantic magazine had an article saying, "Is this the beginning of the end for the reform movement?" Maybe it is. And there has been election after election. Steve Zimmer's victory in Los Angeles, Monica Ratliff's victory in Los Angeles, outspent 4-1, 10-1. Glenda Ritz's victory in Indiana, outspent 10-1. And they won. And as I said, this election just a couple of weeks ago in New York, where the one candidate who was the most outspoken against Bloomberg's education policies won, and his supporter got 15% of the votes. So this is a big change. The public is beginning to get it. Teachers, parents, the public are creating organizations to take back their school, not to go back to the 19th century where children march in straight lines and look straight ahead and do that slant thing. Not to go back to the 20th century, but to build better schools for the 21st century. So I would like to urge you all, because there is one small thing you could do, and that is join the Network for Public Education. And if you have a cell phone, as I'm sure you all do, you text 4, the number 4, NPE, and then when you put in the message, you write in 888-777, and you will in the future get alerts from NPE related to Denver and to Colorado. But NPE is not an organization competing with other organizations. It's trying to network organizations across the country and keep all of us informed about what's happening in Rhode Island, what's happening in Maine, what's happening in Seattle, what's happening everywhere. I mean, we all have to understand that this attack on public education is not about Denver. It's not about Colorado. It's about America. You are part of a much larger whole. So if you, if I may, I just want to conclude by reading. This is a reading. This is the last three paragraphs of my book. And now I've told you so much about my book, you don't have to buy it. But you may want to see the documentation for everything I've said. So I start, this is the way it goes. Yes, we must improve our schools. Start now, start here, by building the bonds of trust among schools and communities. The essential mission of the public schools is not merely to prepare workers for the global workforce, but to prepare citizens with the minds, hearts, and character to sustain our democracy in the future. Genuine school reform must be built on hope, not fear, on encouragement, not threats, on inspiration, not compulsion, on trust, not carrots and sticks, on belief in the dignity of the person, not a slavish devotion to data, on support and mutual respect, not a regime of punishment and blame. To be lasting, school reform must rely on collaboration and teamwork among students, parents, teachers, principals, administrators, and local communities. Despite its faults, the American system of democratically controlled schools has been the mainstay of our communities and the foundation for our nation's success. We must work together to improve our public schools. We must extend the promise of equal educational opportunity to all the children of our nation. Protecting our public schools against privatization and saving them for future generations of American children is the civil rights issue of our time. Thank you.